perfect, doesn't always go in a straight line, we know that. It's transparent though, it's democratic. It works best when it stays close to the people. And the culture of power actually values hearing the truth. I think that's very, very important. Another thing to remember, the role of a public servant, to offer informed, impartial advice based on the evidence, often with some judgment, better be with some judgment, having duly considered the options and engaged people, including yourselves, in the conversation who want and need to be part of that solution ultimately. You won't get that solution unless everyone's involved.
To this we add that men are not corrupted by the exercise of power or debased by the habit of obedience, but by the exercise of a power which they know to be corrupted, and by obedience to a rule which they believe to be oppressive. An artist and part-time activist, Andrew Lockheed, being bored one weekend, saw the results of a vandalized historical entry on Wikipedia for Henry Dundas, committed by Associate Professor of History at the University of Toronto, Dr. Melanie Newton, and wrote a one-page petition asking that Toronto City Council rename Dundas Street. During the executive committee meeting of September 23, 2020, the issue of renaming Dundas Street was first debated.
Okay, so as far as this process for the community process consultation, all the businesses along Dundas and the residential will be individually polled because the people that live on those on the street will be directly impacted financially as well. So they will be all polled, correct?
To the chair, that is correct, Deputy Mayor Nunziata. The objective of the response that we're proposing is to ensure that businesses, citizens, interested parties living along Dundas all have an opportunity to be polled and to give voice to their feelings about any potential changes in name.
What happens when you do the consultation and you do the polling and the majority have opposed it?
Through the chair, certainly if the majority of respondents oppose that, then we would likely be following the will of the citizenry on that point of moving forward.
But I reference this document, a 29-page academic document refuting the allegations that Henry Dundas advanced the slave trade, and makes some fairly compelling arguments with dozens of footnotes, over 100 footnotes. Have city staff read this document or received it?
To the chair, Councillor Pasternak, this recent document that you're referring to, unfortunately, we have not received this one. So we are asking for copies of this document at this time.
City staffer Cheryl Blackman openly lies to the executive committee. The research referred to by Councillor Pasternak has been received several times prior to this meeting and is indicated within the city manager's report for this agenda item, EX 16.3. City staff gave preferential treatment to Melanie Newton within the report while downplaying a substantial research that refuted the specious allegations against Henry Dundas. The city staff report provided four options. The first option, to do nothing, which staff did not recommend, should have been expanded to state that if after an honest search of the facts proved Dundas was not guilty, then the process would end because the petition was found to be without merit. It was predetermined from the start that Henry Dundas was guilty. The council meeting of October 1st, 2020, provided quite a circus. Councillor Carroll refused opportunity to speak during the earlier executive committee meeting, exposing her predetermined decision and bias in a spectacle of emotion, and others followed her example.
We have only one colleague on council who has had this experience. None of us have had the experience of that moment in your childhood when you find out this little piece of history and you realize that just through the accident of birth. You happen to be born at a different time, but through some other accident, all you would have to do is be born at some other time and you could have been bought and sold and held in captivity for your entire life. You learn that if you look in the mirror, you realize that could be you. You realize that that happened to you in another lifetime, a couple of hundred years ago.
So while I'm aware of what was said in the petition, I'm also aware that Mr. Dundas's actions and his actions as a lawyer are recognized by many historians as making a substantial contribution to the abolition of slavery in Scotland. And so how do you square that? This is something that we're going to have to grapple with when this report comes back to this council. If it's established by historians that Mr. Dundas was in fact contributed in a material way to the abolition of slavery in Scotland, why would we be changing that street name?
The fact remains that if our staff or anyone contributing to this report is biasedly anti-racist or impartial to the fact that they abhor racism and this the history of this individual and his contribution to the slave trade, I'm perfectly fine with that.
Frankly, I'm less interested in knowing everything there is to know about Mr. Dundas.
The corruption of process continued, and the direction from the executive and council to do broad consultation with the residents and businesses actually living on Dundas Street were denied. By what authority do city staffers first agree, then refuse to follow direction given? The city staff team of City Manager Chris Murray, Lead Hand Cheryl Blackman, Chief Curator of Museums Wayne Reeves, and Lead Hand Assistant Tamara Williams contracted QuakeLab to assist with the process and, on the consultant's advice, narrowed their focus to exclude all but 25 people from one culture only to decide the fate of renaming Dundas. Ignorant people and those with diminished capacity may be excused for their wild and ludicrous statements, but when well-educated people holding an office or position of authority do this, it is with the intention of doing harm when they owe a duty of care to others.
But imagine if the street were called Gerbil Street or Hindler Street. As a historian, I can say that does not outweigh the great evil he did. After all, people like Goebbels and Himmler, they built cars, they built wonderful roads. That doesn't make us forget what they did.
Historians have the right to interpret facts differently, but not to knowingly misrepresent them.
Well, I mean, in my researches so far, there is no suggestion that Dundas had a commercial interest in either the slave trade or plantation slavery. I do not know of any connection at all. As far as I understand, his wealth would be derived from landholding and his political career.
Henry Dundas, as a lawyer, had successfully defended a former black slave named Joseph Knight to gain his freedom in Scotland. And city staffer Cheryl Blackman sent in a disgraced historian to refute this.
Important to understand that Dundas was a lawyer. Many lawyers were taken on and hired to represent people who were trying to secure their freedom and to prevent their owners from being able to force them back into slavery in the Caribbean. But being a lawyer for someone does not make you necessarily someone who believes in the sort of philosophy of their case. That is his job, right? That was his job.
Valiant efforts were made to turn Blackman's team from this corruption of process.
Every nation has committed atrocities, including First Nations. It is wrong to judge their past actions or ours by present-day standards. Every continent of every race practiced slavery. Europeans were among the first to abolish it. But credit is never given for that. And singling out the British for something that was commonly practiced is hypocritical and, yes, racist. And so much of anti-racism is racist because it points at white people as the only possible racists and white privilege and all the rest of it.
The decision to rename Dundas Street, is I believe it's wrong. But to do so through a process that falls in direct conflict with every policy and principle that council has directed and approved, to do so at a significant cost to the city and to the diverse communities that we wish to support, and to do so without documented majority consent and approval from the diverse communities living on Dundas Street that we wish to empower, I think is wrong.
The city manager's recommendations, paragraph 2, recommends that membership on the Community Advisory Committee be restricted to Black and Indigenous leaders exclusively. All Asians, all white settlers, all brown persons are to be excluded from participation or membership on this committee, excluded because of and due to the color of their skin. Those so excluded make up 90% of the City of Toronto's population.
John Graves Simcoe was trying to curry favor with his boss by naming as many things as he could after him in the province of Ontario, what was then, I guess, Upper Canada.
And so I think what is really an important piece of work that remains in front of the city manager and his team and us is to put a process in place that has people with the confidence that there is a process about this, that it isn't left to some kind of an ad hoc reactionary a kind of a system or set of events that is not the proper way in which to deal with this.
How many general public were consulted?
Councillor Halliday, those folks who are consulted are members of the general public.
So leading into this report, there has not been deep consultation with the general public, other than the 25 that you mentioned.
We have been speaking to those members of the community that are in fact the most impacted by the potential of a name change. Those are members of the Black and Indigenous communities trying to center and focus on those voices.
So you haven't done that broader consultation?
That is correct.
And just because I'm just going to play the devil's advocate for a minute. If we have a petition that's forwarded to City Council that says 100,000 residents sign a petition suggesting that we don't rename Dundas, would you take a similar approach? So therefore you listen to the petitioners and you say, we're not going to go ahead. Is that how this works?
Sorry, City Manager Murray, do you want to take that one?
No.
So therefore you listen to the petitioners and you say, we're not going to go ahead. Is that how this works?
No.
We must be diligent about the standard of proof. The staff report omitted context for Dundas's motion. That is, the previous resounding failures by the British Parliament to legislate abolition, which led to his moderate approach. It ignores evidence that Henry Dundas demonstrated values of equity and inclusion. It ignores the fact that Dundas's plan was not to delay the introduction of abolition. It was to introduce significant measures immediately. This report does not meet the standard of proof.
Before getting into politics, I spent years living and working in post-apartheid South Africa. I recall the outcome of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and it forced some really hard conversations in that country, which were necessary to move forward. And I think back to those years in my work because we're having a similar moment in reckoning in our own country.
But we instructed the city manager to go and do this. In the last report that came around, public consultation comes up prominently, even comes up in the words of the petition and from the letters submitted by members of council that public consultation occur. Yet we find out it was 25 people and some very, very select work done with the BIAs in the area. Why would we do that? Why would we give away the authority to rename a street to the people that live on it? And that's because it's bigger than this chamber. It's bigger than the 26 votes. It's bigger than the 26 members of council.
And the very fact, with no disrespect, that Deputy Mayor Holliday could cite two little tiny phrases that seem to suggest maybe that at one time he'd spoken a word in Parliament about his siding with the abolitionists, to me, is not a very strong record.
And these are the elected members of council who voted to scapegoat Henry Dundas from their sanctimonious chamber of righteousness, though they had clear evidence they knew they were committing an injustice. The conclusion was determined from the start, when no discipline was used to answer the questions of guilt. An accusation became a conviction of Henry Dundas. There was no reasonable logic and no academic methodology to city staff reports and recommendations to council, and council knew it and pushed on, knowing it would do harm to Torontonians they owed a duty of care.
Politics has trumped evidence. And this happened from the very beginning when our city manager said the status quo is not an option. Before this process even began, he'd already formed an opinion that the idea of doing nothing wasn't acceptable. It was already prejudged by a city manager. And therefore, what has happened is it was an outcome that was already started to set out. And so it was already a tainted process.
Good government matters. Only from what I can see, based on the facts, governance and accountability have been lacking in the way the project to rename Dundas Street has been conducted. I call this a project because, of course, it was a foregone conclusion, wasn't it? Not a question, not a quest for facts, not a desire for truth. What does it matter because the guy's been dead for over 200 years? Except that it does. Two wrongs don't make a right. There is no honor there.
Henry Dundas is somewhat more nuanced, and I know you don't want to go into that, but we saw an example of shameful disregard for evidence. And I'm very concerned as a historian, a social scientist and a historian, by the lack of respect for evidence. I think it needs to be very important.
I also want to just address the you know, what the deputy mayor referred to as the shameful disregard of the evidence, and I think he was quoting some of the deputants, and I heard some of those people saying that. I guess I would be in a position with all this, because I've read a lot of the stuff that has come out. I wouldn't know what to believe, frankly, in terms of the history. I mean, there's been so many different accounts of history from a lot of people that have a lot of letters after their name that, you know, you don't really know, I mean, what has gone on, and that's part of the difficulty in all of this. So I look at it and say, you know, which evidence are we shamefully disregarding?
The hard financial cost cash out to my business in 2018 was $35,000. However, there's a 2 to 3 month period before a move and a 3 to 6 month time period after a move where there's a great disruption in the business because of the obvious people don't necessarily know where to send checks, your banking information is not accurate, contracts, all sorts of matters corporately have to be adjusted to reflect the change in the street name. I calculated that as 2 full-time staff for 3 months and 2 half-time staff for 3 months. If you add those staff hours, the value of them, to the $35,000, it would have cost me $100,000 to move offices on the street name change only.
Adopting the commemorative framework, the power to exact a name change, was almost a non-issue and yet revealed some dark attitudes.
All of these motions are fine if you're comfortable that you have benefited from white supremacy from the minute you were born to every minute of your life, and if you should so choose to name a street. But we're having this conversation because there are large communities that don't have the money to change the name of the big street that shall remain nameless. But in a country as redneck and as backward as the United States, in every city, because that's not what we're supposed to be doing right now, quite frankly, as white people who cannot deny that from birth to every minute you live, you benefit from being white.
The December 14th, 2023 City Council meeting was an historical and disgraceful political abuse of the people of Toronto. Some council members and city staff used emotional hysteria to justify their abuse based on a narrow-minded, unhistorical outrage of a mob.
To the city clerk, where can I see correspondence on this item?
At present, there are no pieces of correspondence.
Okay, but what I don't understand is there's a big, you know, we're built on public consultation, Toronto. So I don't understand why we are, first of all, tell me why this is a member motion instead of a staff report. And second of all, tell me where the public consultation piece fell through the cracks. Okay, but just to be clear, it didn't go out to the public outside of the committee, correct?
Councillor Robinson, you are correct.
I know many
young black boys and girls, grandparents are watching us here today and really reflecting and feeling that the city sees them, perhaps for the first time.
Between 2007 and 2023 alone, the City Council of Toronto adopted 180 separate motions with many recommendations from Toronto City staff for programs providing many millions of dollars in support of the Black community of Toronto alone.
My concern, however, with this motion is about process. Proper process is essential for government decisions to have legitimacy. And no proper process has been followed in this case. Councillor Robinson already pointed out the public were promised a chance to have input. Seems to me that we have three inappropriate things that we're being asked to do without notice in a rush tonight. And the central one is that it's, first of all, we're excluding the public. As Councillor Holliday pointed out, there's no communications. There was no public consultation.
Councillor Carroll carried on quite poetically about the word Sankofa from Ghana, but neglects to mention that the Akan people of Ghana apologized in 2006 with Project Joseph, which was an invitation to the blacks of the world to visit Ghana and know that the people of Ghana were sorry they had sold so many of their ancestors into slavery.
It's been a long journey to get us here, starting in the wake of the murder of George Floyd. 14,000 people signed a petition calling for Toronto to reconcile with our history of honoring Henry Dundas, perpetrator of the transatlantic slave trade. I heard some conversation that wasn't much of a process. How could it be not much of a process? We went through 2 years of meeting. So I believe that is a pretty good process.
During the Dundas fiasco, Sir Tom Devine, Scotland's most eminent historian, submitted his thoughts on the renaming of Dundas on 10 July 2022. Others had previously submitted statements by this scholar. He stated, "I personally have had an earlier meeting by Zoom on 19 November 2020 with Toronto Museum officials who were preparing reports on historical background to the case for renaming the street. The individuals involved were Cyril Blackman, Tamara Williams, and Wayne Reeves. It was not a happy experience, as it quickly became clear to me that their interest was in finding Dundas guilty and not listening impartially to different perspectives from an established scholar in the relevant field. They promised to talk to me again and invite me to take part in a series of seminars they were planning on the subject. Neither took place. It was nothing less than gross discourtesy on their part. More importantly, I was convinced they had already made up their minds and were simply looking for evidence to support their opinions." Mayor John Tory's response was to publicly insult and reject Sir Tom Devine and all academics who spoke out against the corruption of process by Toronto City staff, with his full support and participation, when he said,
"I also want to just address the, what the deputy mayor referred to as the shameful disregard of the evidence, and I think he was quoting some of the deputants, and I heard some of those people saying that. I guess I would be in a position with all this, because I've read a lot of the stuff that has come out. I wouldn't know what to believe, frankly, in terms of the history. I mean, there's been so many different accounts of history from a lot of people that have a lot of letters after their name that, you know, you don't really know, I mean, what has gone on, and that's part of the difficulty in all of this."
When these members of Toronto City Council are out trying to get re-elected, they show one happy, civil face to their constituents. But when granted the privilege of office, they reveal their true self and trot out their personal agendas. Their transition can be seen on a YouTube public display of Toronto's executive and city council circus. Who do the elected and city staff really represent?